committed the ultimate crime, that of conceiving a second child. Brennick is captured and given the maximum sentence, life in the fortress, a 30-story prison buried deep in the Arizona desert. Life in the fortress is hellish. Inmates are fitted with intestinators, devices which cause pain or death if the rules are broken, and the whole operation is presided over by a terribly evil warden. Brennick discovers that the rule of thumb is kill or be killed.
You are about to be outfitted with intestinators, Mentel Corporation's automatic behavior control device. Observe all rules. Be especially observant of the yellow and red line. Crossing a yellow line will result in pain. Crossing a red line will result in death. Crime does not pay.
Amongst all this, Brennick discovers his wife is not only in the same prison, but is being forced to be the warden's concubine. So it's time to start thinking of rescuing her and escaping from the fortress forever. Thus, Brennick and a few other cons work out how to get rid of their intestinators and raise a bit of hell en route.
Look, this could be a way out.
Oh,
hold it steady.
Sorry. This thing's just heating up. Sorry.
We go in through the construction area here, through this heating pipe. See? It feeds into this utility shaft, which goes all the way up.
Fortress is a pretty standard prison movie, which makes one hope that this particular genre isn't making a comeback. The violence is way over the top, and there's a total lack of any suspense or excitement. Lambert seems to be going through the motions, and all in all, it looks like it was as much of a waste of his time as it will be of yours if you watch it. And now...
The big picture!
Jean-Claude Van Damme must be a happy chap at the moment. His last three films seem to have liberated him from the video shelves once and for all. His latest, Time Cop, seems also destined for box office success, armed with a big budget, futuristic setting, and literally brimming with Van Damme's unmistakable brand of martial artistry. It's 2004, and time travel has become a reality. Van Damme plays Max Walker, a time cop whose job is to see that time travel isn't abused.
Got to take you back.
I went 10 rounds with John L. Sullivan himself.
So, whilst Max tries to thwart the plans of evil Senator Ron Silver, who fancies rewriting history to make himself president, he's also torn between making his own present a little more palatable by preventing the murder of his wife 10 years earlier.
Who are you?
It's me. Look, it's Max.
Max? What happened?
I can't tell you right now. We have to go. Trust me. Trust me.
It has a nice touch of romance and sadness into it, and a change of character when you have the young Walker, myself, and then later on the old Walker. He's a different type of guy, and he's trying to get out of it. It's impossible. So as a coincidence in the film, it will connect later in the past. I was sad, I was strong, melancholic. And the young Walker was like a happy camper, so I was able to show more emotion than what I've done in the past.
Oh my God!
It's me. It's Max.
I can't believe this.
Try.
When am I like 10 years from now?
Just like now. Perfect.
Acting to me is acting, and I've learned a lot of books about acting the last couple of months, and you've got the inside. I mean, you've got your emotion, you can show sadness, fear, depending how serious you're taking your character. But also you have physical acting. I mean, rolling on the floor, getting sick, upset stomach, or getting hit. It's acting because I've got no scars here.
Have a nice day.
It's even more hard to do an action film with a dramatic scene following up than just a dramatic scene. Because you go on very strong physical emotion, then you have to quiet down, relax, go back to your trailer, and to become a different person. And if you, ask Brando, he will tell you the same stuff. I mean, it's like big movie stars, big actors will tell you the same. So it's, you know what, we box office. They love our movies, they bang the tickets, that means we're doing something good, I guess.
Launch now on full mastery.
On Back to the Future, they spend millions and millions of dollars to try to explain the time traveling process. Don't do that, just go back to the past or the future, and you have your own vision as a director or as the audience of what's going to happen. And it's kind of exciting. But you need a good story, of course, and good action and all that stuff. No, I'm working on a movie called The Quest. I will direct in New York, China, Tibet, and Thailand, starting in March. But we have two movies now in the can, Street Fighter and Sudden Death. And of course, Time Cop, opening soon.
And we continue the adventure fantasy theme with the next film, Stargate. When an ancient engraved circle is uncovered at Giza, brilliant Egyptologist Daniel Jackson, James Spader, is called in to try and decipher the strange hieroglyphics which adorn it. This he does and manages to identify the object as being a Stargate, a portal to another world. Joined by a squad of crack commandos led by Colonel Jack O'Neill, Kurt Russell, Spader ventures forth into the great unknown. Traveling through the Stargate, Spader, Russell, and co. find themselves on an alien planet whose inhabitants are enslaved by Ra, the sun god, a despotic alien who resides in a massive pyramid spaceship. Stunned to find the Stargate still works, Ra and his chums seek to repel the invaders and destroy Earth before the same thing happens to them.
What is that? That's a bomb, isn't it? That's what you were looking for. What the hell were you thinking? What'd you come here for?
Stargate is simply an excellent film which manages to top any of the summer blockbusters last year. The originality of the story and the engaging performances combine with some stunning special effects to create a truly fantastical adventure. Across between Close Encounters of the Third Kind and Raiders of the Lost Ark, this is the stuff that escapism is made of.